The Philippines will implement tighter quarantine restrictions and reimpose the outdoor ban on children after it confirmed the local transmission of the Delta COVID-19 variant. We'll be joined by the regional head of the health department in Calabarzon to discuss the Delta variant cases in the region. The Philippines includes Malaysia and Thailand in its COVID-19 travel ban. Filipino artists express their displeasure with government in a viral online campaign ahead of the president's final State of the Nation address. We'll speak to the creator of Tumindig later on in the program. And Olympic Filipino rower Chris Nevarez advances to the quarterfinals of his event ahead of the official start of the Tokyo Games. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Hey, thanks for joining us. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad to have you with us today. The National Capital Region and four other provinces in the Philippines placed under general community quarantine with heightened restrictions until the end of the month. That's after the Philippines confirmed the local transmission of the more contagious Delta COVID-19 variant. The provinces that were placed under GCQ with heightened restrictions starting today are Ilocos Norte, Ilocos Sur, Davao de Oro, and Davao del Norte. Meanwhile, Davao del Sur is placed under regular GCQ. Under the GCQ with heightened restrictions, seating capacity for indoor dining will be at 20% and 50% for outdoor dining. Personal care services such as salons and spas, as well as outdoor tourist attractions, will be allowed at 30% capacity. Meanwhile, minors are again banned from going outside.
Na po tayo. Pilipinas, sa ngalan po ng inyong Presidente Rodrigo Roa Duterte, ito po ang...
The Philippines has included Malaysia and Thailand in its travel ban in a bid to prevent the spread of the Delta variant. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque says the travel ban will take effect from July 25th until the 31st. The Philippines had previously banned travelers from 8 countries, including Indonesia and India.
Hindi po pwedeng pumasok ngayon, bukod pa doon sa mga ibang bansa na may travel ban na, ang manggagaling sa Malaysia at Thailand. Lahat po ng nakatransit na po o papunta na ng Pilipinas, no? At lahat po na darating ng 14 days immediately preceding the arrival of the Philippines, pero bago po ng 12:01 of July 25, 2021, ay po pwede pa rin pong makapasok sa bansa, pero subject to full 14-day facility quarantine, notwithstanding po kung negatibo ang kanilang RT-PCR results. Now, siyempre po, subject itong travel ban ito sa usual exception na yung mga Pilipino nakabahagi ng repatriation and special commercial flights.
As for fully vaccinated travelers coming from the so-called green or low-risk countries, Roque says they can enter the Philippines and undergo a shorter 7-day facility-based quarantine. RT-PCR testing will be conducted on the 5th day. This new policy will take effect on July 26th. The health department on Thursday confirmed there is already local transmission of the Delta variant in the Philippines. The DOH also reported a dozen new local cases. 8 of those cases are still considered active. The DOH suspects breaches in quarantine protocols led to the local transmissions. The DOH adds stringent measures are being implemented so the healthcare system will not be overwhelmed.
The stringent measures would be, first, we have started coordinating with our local governments. We have emphasized that they need to implement the strict border controls. They have to implement strictly the PDITR. They have to shorten the duration between detection to isolation so that we can cut the transmission in the community. And foremost, contact tracing should be expanded to the third generation. And we are now ramping up also our biosurveillance efforts so that we can detect or determine if the Delta variant is in other places as well.
The DOH also denies it was remiss in informing its regional offices of the Delta strain. The mayor of Calamba in Laguna calling out the health department for supposedly not giving him a heads up about the two Delta variant cases in his city before announcing it to media. Mayor Timmy Chipeco assures the public both patients already tested negative for the virus before they were discharged from the hospital last July 12th.
What I'm asking with the DOH, come on, you be sensitive enough to call us LGU first and confirm what has really happened. Not just announce it to the media that we have a Delta variant case at this point in time. And then what? Because you create panic, you create chaos. So are you helping us? You're not helping us. Mm-hmm. You're just giving us more problems.
The two Delta variant cases in Calamba were the first recorded cases of the more contagious variant for the entire Calabarzon region. And let's get more details now on the Delta variant cases in Laguna. We're joined now by Dr. Eduardo Janeiro. He is the regional director of the health department in Calabarzon. Dr. Janeiro, welcome to the program. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Casey, and thank you for having me.
All right. When we talk about the Delta variant cases in Calabarzon, we're not just talking about two here. The total now is at five. Can you break that down for us?
Okay. Actually, you have to determine first the situation. The last two, which was actually a case of June pa, no? Mm. It's more an unknown source ng Delta. But the first three understood na sila galing abroad, overseas Filipino and returning Filipinos. Mm-hmm. So workers and returning Filipinos. And before they entered their communities, residences in one in Bawan and the other one in the two others in Cavite, nag-negative na sila, they recovered before they were sent home. Actually, okay. One already returned to the Middle East for work. Right. So okay. Even in situation. So now what we have, yung two Delta variants, which up to now, we don't know anong source niya, although they have recovered already.
Okay. Do they have any history of travel, these two new cases?
No, the whole family has no history of travel, nor any. To date, this moment, I was informed that there were no visitors coming from abroad, nor they have met anybody outside their homes.
So, did they go out?
Yeah, ito nga, we have to emphasize this. They were going out only for two things, going to the pharmacies and to the groceries. And these are all enclosed areas. Mm-hmm. So if you are in these areas, it's a probability, kasi sabi nga natin, the Delta variant is very highly transmissible. Mm-hmm. Madaanan ka lang daw ng positive, magkakaroon ka na. And mm-hmm. not only that, medyo serious ang case mo pag ikaw ay nagkaroon yan. So in those enclosed areas, we have to be very careful. Yung distancing, face mask and face shield should be really adhered to, especially when you go home, you wash your hands. Okay. So napaka-importante niyan nga yung istoryang yun kasi wala nang history ng really going out except for those two areas.
Let's talk about the timeline here. When were they diagnosed?
Okay, the
to
first
have COVID
one,
pa lang ha, to have COVID.
Yeah. Okay, the first one who had diagnosed as COVID, yung mother, yung babae, 58 years old na female, diagnosed June 21, I think. So earlier yun, with symptoms na. However, the problem with the female, meron siyang comorbid. So comorbid niya diabetes and colon cancer. Okay. Now, the two others, yung father at saka yung isang son, that's 29 years old, nag-positive siya on the 27th. So, 24th sila lahat napunta sa San Pablo District Hospital. And they recovered, yung dalawa. But the mother died July 10.
Okay, so sorry to cut you there, Dr. Rat. So, six cases kayo with one fatality.
No, hindi diagnosed as variant yung ating fatality.
Mother.
Yes.
Okay.
Hindi na napadala sa genome center.
Hindi na naipadala. Okay, pero hindi pa pwedeng gawin, can't you do it belatedly?
No, he doesn't meet the criteria. Di ba yung nasabi nating viral load? Kailangan ma-panyon.
Yeah.
Ma-follow.
Okay. And so, the father and son, have they recovered already?
Yeah, they have recovered. Nag-negative ang RT-PCR nila July 9. However, we heard of the news na Delta positive siya just Wednesday night. Okay? Matagal yung genome announcement. So, they have to redo an RT-PCR, quarantine first, and then once the RT-PCR results came out at negative, then they can go back home.
Okay, so when did you send the samples from the father and son for genome sequencing, and what prompted you to do so?
Okay, ang nakakalam talaga niya, San Pablo District Hospital, not us, kasi they were in the hospitals during that time. They were given the RT-PCR, and once, nung nag-positive ng June 27, they sent the sample, kasi yung viral load na mataas, to the genome center.
Okay. And here's where the, I guess, confusion lies as well, right, and also the source of panic, because we also heard from Mayor Isko Moreno that they were also belatedly informed about the Delta variant cases in their area 3 weeks after. So the question now is, as you monitor these patients, can't you have a better system of informing the LGUs even without knowing yet that they are positive with the Delta variant? Only knowing the cycle threshold, can you at least give them a warning that maybe these are cases being suspected of being Delta?
That would be a very hard activity to do. For one, there is no such policy informing anybody of probabilities in Delta. The more panic that you will create. You see, yun yung magiging problema nun. Now, sabi ko nga kanina, there is a failure of system, especially on communication. Because the idea here is there is only one who will announce for significant or critical information. So we are not allowed to give it. Kaya yesterday when I was interviewed by ABS-CBN, I was surprised how did they know na may Delta variant sa Calamba, which I known only the night before. So yun yung mga bits of communication then when it comes to the information. And so, I hope this would be understood. Know very well by those people have been affected and emotionally carried into the positivity of Delta.
But here's the thing, Dr. Janairo, panic is one thing, being prepared is another thing. Right. I mean, just panicking for the sake of panicking, that won't get us anywhere. Good. But if you panic towards, you know, being prepared, because we know how deadly this virus is, you know, wouldn't you take that extra step? But as you said, your hands are tied. So is the conclusion now there is something wrong with the system?
Yeah, as I said nga, may failure of system na tayo because of the communication breach na hindi natin malaman kung saan ang gagaling. However, sabi ko nga kanina rin, so in all of the interviews, panic is created by not the person giving the information. It is created by the person receiving the information. So it really depends on how you accept this information. In the first place, it is an information that you have to really know in the first, no matter what timing. So it's really how you have it. And in the first place, everybody should have been prepared in this COVID surge that we have.
Yeah.
So there's no need to have additional preparation.
No, but that's easier said than done. I mean, we just heard from the DOH undersecretary saying that there may have been breaches in quarantine protocols that led to the local transmissions.
So that's true. It's already true because we have already some cases that we don't know where it came from.
Oh.
So it's almost everywhere in the system that there are some failures.
Mm.
Okay. Not only in communication, but in all the policy implementation. So with this, we have to be ready because this cannot be controlled. You see, it can always happen.
Are you accepting of the fact that there are breaches in protocols, and you know, yes, you're just going to accept it, and you're not going to try and plug the loopholes?
No, that has been being tried, but we are becoming reactive because we don't know it's happening in the first place. But we are always trying to prevent it. But whatever we do, it will happen.
And that's exactly what is happening in these countries that are currently battling surges and infections because of the Delta variant, Dr. Hanayro.
Yes.
So is it a foregone conclusion that we're just going to have to wait till this explodes?
No, not really. But what we're doing right now is really preparing for whatever, what will happen. We don't know yet if there will be additional surges. Okay. If there will be a real surge because of the Delta variant. We might have a surge, not because of the Delta, but the usually common spread of the COVID virus. Hmm. But the thing is, we need to prepare our system and everybody else for this kind of surge, which is happening from intermittently. Nakita nyo, we have increased 1 month, another month slow, another month increase. It's happening, but in this case, we know already the trend. We have to be prepared whatever happens.
Let's go back to the two new cases of Delta variant there in Calabarzon. Contact tracing, what can you tell us about the latest in contact tracing efforts?
Okay, they are doing it already with the local government. We have also our regional level going at the field level. Mm-hmm. Pero to date, ang report pa lang nila, indirect communication, indirect exposure pa lang nung household helper at saka yung another son.
Opa.
But outside, they're still looking. Actually, ang objective nila is to get into the third generation
right.
Para, but we need a lot of investigation activities, asking activities in this case.
Yeah, because you said they would only go out for essentials, going to right. the pharmacies, going to the groceries. Do we know at least if they've gotten, if the contact tracers have gotten in touch with these establishments? And is the investigation there underway as well?
That's true. We are actually having retroactively having the history of the activities of the various patients that we have here in that barangay. Mm-hmm. Even their activities, kasi sabi nga, it's work-based, home-based sila, ang work. However, there might be an incident they went to the office to get something or get into some information or some activities outside the homes, which we really have to dig up.
Okay. And how much time are you giving yourself here? Because as you're doing that, you know, we need time here.
Actually, they started yesterday, and today is the final day that we get the most information that we could to start the basic activity or strategies that we will do at the local level.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. I think you've got your work cut out for you. Dr. Eduardo Hanayro, Regional Director of the DOH Calabarzon, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon.
Yeah.
Thanks again. All right, moving on. The Philippines reported 5,828 new COVID-19 infections Thursday. This brings the nationwide tally to 1,530,000. Of that number, 50,562 are active cases, the highest in nearly 3 weeks. 17 more died. That's the lowest in almost 4 months. But the health department notes Thursday's numbers may not be up to date due to technical problems hounding its data collating system. The Philippines receives an additional 1 million doses of Sinovac's COVID-19 vaccine. This brings the total number of the Chinese-made vaccines in the country to 17 million. As of July 21st, 5.2 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. 10.7 million have received their first dose. The World Health Organization urging Indonesia to implement a stricter and wider COVID-19 lockdown. The Southeast Asian country has become one of the epicenters of the global pandemic in recent weeks. Daily infections there have increased fivefold, and daily deaths hit record highs of more than 1,400. But on Thursday, President Joko Widodo floated a possible easing of restrictions, citing official data showing a drop in infections. But experts point out the dip is driven by a drop in testing. The WHO says government needs to address the outbreaks in 13 of Indonesia's 34 provinces. Indonesia's partial lockdown has been limited to the island of Java and Bali and small pockets in other parts of the country. The U.S. government has not revised its guidance for wearing face masks, even as the infectious COVID-19 Delta variant continues to sweep the country. The director of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says only unvaccinated or the unvaccinated need to continue wearing masks.
Fully vaccinated people are protected from severe illness. And we've always said that communities and individuals need to make the decisions that are right for them based on what's going on in their local areas.
U.S. President Joe Biden insists newer infections are mostly unvaccinated people.
We follow the science. We have a pandemic among the non-vaccinated. Those who are not vaccinated. If you are vaccinated, you are safe. If you are vaccinated, you have over a 98% chance of never catching the virus at all. If you catch it, you're likely to, the overwhelming proof so far is you're not going to be hospitalized, you're not going to be sick, you're going to probably have no signs that you had it, and you are not going to die.
Up ahead, we'll talk to the artist behind a digital drawing depicting dissent that sparked an online campaign. We'll be right back. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
And we are back, or still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. The Philippines will implement tighter quarantine restrictions and reimpose the outdoor ban on children after WHIT confirmed the local transmission of the Delta COVID-19 variant. The Philippines includes Malaysia and Thailand in its COVID-19 travel ban. Filipino artists express their displeasure with government in a viral online campaign ahead of the president's final State of the Nation address. And Olympic Filipino rower Chris Nevarez advances to the quarterfinals of his event ahead of the official start of the Tokyo Games. Back with more news. Over in China, tens of thousands are evacuated from flood-hit regions as the death toll there rises to 33. And as this report tells us, the bad weather is expected to continue for a few more days.
From the air, the devastation in Zhengzhou is seen at its worst. Tens of thousands of people have been evacuated from the industrial hub in China's central Henan province. And dams and reservoirs have swelled to warning levels as rainfall levels shattered records. Dozens have died in the province over the last few days, a number of them in a flooded subway where the waters reached shoulder level, as seen in this eyewitness video from Tuesday. Yang Yanling is the mother of two daughters. Clutching her little girl's hand, she says she's been trapped in her home for 3 days.
Because we are scared and worried there will be no food or drinks anymore, as we had no contact with the outside world. The family and relatives cannot contact us. They must be very worried. And we are also very anxious. We are also worried and afraid that there will be more serious floods. Both the first and second floors of the basement were flooded with water, so we are worried about the safety of our lives.
Bulldozers were used to pull people to safety, with some desperately clinging to the machines for a chance to escape. More rain is forecast across Henan for the next 3 days, and the People's Liberation Army has sent more than 5,500 soldiers and personnel to help with search and rescue.
Here in the Philippines, more coastal communities in Cavite suffered destruction brought about by strong waves whipped up by the typhoon enhanced southwest monsoon. More than 36 families were forced to evacuate. Others who stayed behind put up makeshift barriers to protect their homes from the huge waves. Incessant rains triggered landslides in Olongapo City as well. Residents in the affected village were ordered to evacuate. Up north, several major roads going to Baguio City were unpassable due to landslides. The heavy rains also flooded parts of Metro Manila. Allies and critics of the Duterte administration preparing for President Duterte's final State of the Nation address on Monday. And as RJ Cruz tells us, one thing that is not expected to be tackled during the sauna, the chief executive's plan for the upcoming elections.
4 days to go before President Duterte delivers his final State of the Nation address, the House of Representatives prepared a 4-minute tribute video highlighting his legislative achievements and key projects. The House also launched a special website highlighting these achievements. But the Makabayan Bloc can only scoff at the achievements.
Sa halip na irregularize yung mga kontraktual, tila siya ang gusto maging regular, ano? Si Pangulong Duterte. Kasi pagkatapos maging Pangulo, gusto pa niyang tumakbo ngayon bilang vice-presidente.
Kalabasa Award ang ibinigay ng ating mga kaguruan dito sa tandem ni President Duterte at ni Secretary Briones dahil sa hindi pagtugon doon sa kahilingan, kahingian ng ating mga teachers.
But the palace says...
Well, siguro po hindi mapapasama ang kanyang mga planong politikal. Importante po is the roadmap for his last year in office.
The president already rehearsed for his final report to the nation, while the palace gave a preview of the big speech.
Ang alam ko po, ang magiging forma ng kanyang SONA ay titingnan po niya yung mga nakalipas na 5 taon na siya ay naging presidente at pupokus po siya siyempre sa pag-unlad ng bayan, dun sa ating mga social programs, infrastructure, peace and security, foreign policy.
The House has been a hive of activity these past few days for the President's final SONA. Government critics are also ready. They will march from the University Avenue to St. Peter's Church along Commonwealth Avenue for a short program, but they vow to adhere to COVID-19 health protocols.
Umaasa kami na yung PNP ay tutupad dun sa naging usapan. Malinaw po yung naging parameters at susundin naman.
These artists are working on the centerpiece of the march.
Andun si Duterte, siya yung pinaka-main na kapito ko. Tapos may baby na Sara Duterte na maliliit na toko. Tapos de syempre nandito rin yung mga tinatawag namin alipores niya, sina Harry Roque, Panelo, si Anyo, tsaka si Esperon.
The House is also ready for them. It is coordinating with the AFP and PNP, though they see no major security threat. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Artists in the Philippines using their craft to express dissent online. Last week, visual artist Kevin Raimundo posted a digital drawing of a person depicted as a fist, standing out in a crowd of bowed hands, depicting President Duterte's fist bump gesture. That digital art has blown up, with many artists adding their own fist avatars. And to tell us more about this online campaign now known as Tumindig, is its creator, Kevin Raimundo, also known as Kevin Calvo, also known as TK. Good afternoon, Kevin. Thanks for joining us today. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Casey.
All right, let me ask you first, ilan ang nagawa mo in the past, how many days? Let's begin with how many you've done in the past 24 hours of these fist avatars.
Actually, yung mga fist avatars, hindi ako mismo yung gumagawa ng mga versions nila. Hmm. Sila mismo yung gumagawa noon. And they're the ones adding to the artwork itself.
Pero merong mga ibang artists that have decided to make for yes. these people.
Yes.
And we're going to talk to one of them later on in the program. But first, I want to ask you, what was that thought that brought this into life?
Kasi nung time na yun, ang daming balita na lumalabas na sobrang depressing, especially with the coming elections. Parang ang daming mga nagpaparamdam na mga politicians who want our vote. And para sa akin, I felt the need to para ilabas yung nararamdaman ko. Yun lang naman yung purpose ng artwork na yun, is to show what I'm feeling.
Nagulat ka ba?
Yes. Hindi, sobrang hindi ko siya in-expect na it would blow up na ganun kalaki.
Oo, kasi it was a personal expression
yes.
of dissent
yes.
and disgust.
Yes, yun lang yun.
Mm. Gaano ba ka-importante sa iyo bilang visual artist, Kevin, na ilagay sa sentro ng iyong art, no, ng iyong craft, ang bayan? Na hindi siya dapat lang basta art for art's sake, pero kailangan din ito makatulong sa pagmumulat ng kamalayan, pagmumulat ng mga natutulog pa or nagtutulog-tulugan. Kevin?
Para sa akin kasi, art is always political, whether you like it or not. Kumbaga, hindi siya just for aesthetics. Even if you choose not to participate dun sa political discourse, that in itself is staying silent. And when you stay silent, you are siding with the oppressors. Yeah.
Where did you get this? This fuel of yours to make art for the people, for the country?
Para sa akin, it's just a drive. Eh. Parang this is what I am. Palaging yung nilalabas ko sa artwork ko is always coming from honesty.
Mm. And when you started getting all these hits and interests and likes dito sa sinimulan mong tumindig, aside from nagulat, Ano pa yung naramdaman mo at ano yung naisip mo?
Naisip ko na meron pa pala tayong hope. Yan. Yan yung pinaka naramdaman ko. Kasi for the longest time, these past few years, I'm sure a lot of people, ganun din yung naramdaman nila na parang ang hopeless nung bansa natin sa mga nangyayari. And nung nakita ko na merong sumama sa akin, doon ko naramdaman na hindi pala ako nag-iisa. Madami pala tayo.
Parang napakaganda nung sinabi mo, Kevin, because it went full circle. You expressed, yes. You were hopeless.
Yes.
And because you were hopeless, you had to find a way to express that disgust and dissent, mm-hmm. only to be given hope by those who found hope in your art.
Yes, yes. Kaya right? Sobrang nakakatuwa.
And one of those who is helping spread the fire is visual artist Jason Moss. And we're going to talk to him right now. Jason, welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, good afternoon.
Ito ang alam ko na puyat. How many avatars did you work on in the past 24 hours?
Almost close to 100, and it's still adding up as we speak. So, yeah, I'm enjoying it.
You're enjoying it.
Thanks to, course.
And you're enjoying it so much. I mean, this is not new to you. You were an editorial artist for the Today newspaper. And when you were doing that, you had your fair share of bashers. But did that at all prepare you for the kind of bashing that you receive when you start making these avatars this time around, Jason?
It doesn't disturb me at all. Of course, merong halong kaba din, but I guess we're doing good. We're doing right. So the more death threats you get, I guess it means that we're doing a good job, right, Kevin?
Yes,
Kevin's doing a good job. So yeah. So,
well, what made you decide to take on the cost, Jason? And first of all, let me just backtrack a bit. When did you first see it? The movement start to come into a life of its own? And when did you start to think, I want to be part of this?
Well, personally, kasi I'm in grieving. And it does help me move forward if I help people. It's always been that way. So it feels good to do the right thing. And push forward with it, with this collective dissent. So
I do want to take this moment to offer you my condolences on the passing of your father, and know that you and your father were really the best of friends, as he told me last night. So again, please accept my deepest condolences. And do you think that this is one thing that your father would have approved of? For sure,
yeah. Of course.
What do you think is the key here for other artists like you to be part of this movement? Why is it imperative for artists like yourself to be part of a movement like this?
Well, of course we have to raise awareness. Among other things, protesting against the anti-terror law. Of course, it does move me to at least spark change, like what Kevin's been doing. I'm kind of used to this as well because I do belong to other groups. When I was younger, I was active helping out a lot of NGOs as well, environmental, education, etc. So it's really nothing new. I really involve myself in these things. And of course, drawing support for Kevin as well.
Yeah. Let me just go back to Kevin now. Kevin, naisip mo ba na tatawagin itong movement? Because that's what people are calling it now.
No, hindi talaga. Yung original post.
Siya, let me just add this, Kevin. At hindi lang siya movement, tinatawag na movement, pero isa siyang movement na nangyayari sa gitna ng isang pandemya.
Yes. Sobrang overwhelming siya for me. Yung actual na piece na ginawa ko, wala siyang, hindi ko siya nilagyan ng context. It's just a bunch of fists na naka-fist bump and at the same time nakaluhod. So nagulat ako in a sense na na-connect ng mga tao kung ano yung iniisip ko making that artwork. Yeah.
Pagkatapos, kailan nangyari? Kwento mo sa amin yung konsepto. How did it come to this from that artwork? Na biglang dumami na tong mga kamao at inisip mo ba na mula dun sa kamaong yun, magiging ganito ang magiging takbo? No, e ganito ay magiging buhay ng artwork mo.
Yung isang yung pinakaunang nag-join dun sa movement, kaibigan ko siya, si Alan Laycano.
Mm-hmm.
Was commonly known as Kapitan Tambay. Isa din siyang komikero katulad ko.
Mm-hmm.
And nag-usa siya to add his avatar there. And then nung nakita ko, ni-retweet ko lang siya. It's just a simple retweet.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, dun na siya nag-balloon into what it is now.
Mm-hmm. You didn't think of this as sort of a pre-sauna, di ba? Hindi
no,
na kasi ngayon.
Hindi talaga.
Sinasabi na that this is about, you know, the final State of the Nation address. But Jason, do you think that this is going to go beyond the final State of the Nation address of the president?
Yes. It will.
And why do you think?
It's gaining a lot of traction. It's getting bigger than it is. And I won't be surprised if it's going to mutate into something bigger than it is.
And why do you think people can easily resonate? It's a very simple yes. Artwork. Hindi ba?
Yun mismo yung reason bakit mas gusto nila. Kasi hindi siya angry in a sense na violent, ganun.
Yeah.
Mas positive yung ini-imbibe ng art.
Mm-hmm.
It's very simple. Madali siyang i-drawing. Mm-hmm. Madaming nagtatanong, nagpapadrawing sa akin kasi hindi sila artists. But they want to join the cause.
At saka, Jason, it embodies, I mean, alam naman natin yung simbolo ng kamao, di ba? Pero to be able to translate it in a very simple, non-violent, accepted form, yung without judgment right away, hindi ba? Mm-hmm. Parang ang hindi ko alam ke, Jason, but I mean you guys are the artists here. I'm just the one who appreciates it. But to be able to see that fist and feel that it's okay to have a dissenting opinion is already very powerful, especially in these times.
Yes.
I mean, we can't go outside. We can't do this on EDSA. Having a bunch of fists represent us is, I guess it's safe. At least you're being counted. At least you're being heard. And of course, a lot of people want to be part of this, not because it looks good, not because, you know, oh, I'm going to have my own avatar. We do, and they do want to be part of this. It's not some novelty. Oh, it's so cute. Let me have one. You do have to understand why you want it, why you want to be there, and why you're joining this cause.
Yeah, and I think that's the beauty of dressing up these avatars as your own person.
Mm-hmm.
Hindi ba? Parang you're very, very connected
yes.
with that form of dissent. Tell us about the very interesting creations that you've done so far, Jason. Ano mga, and how does it go? Do they DM you? Do they tell you, I want to have this component again, or this is my picture, depict me as closest to this? How does it go?
Well, it started off as yung mga friends ko from FB. Uh-huh. Tapos parang dumami siya ng dumami, and then friends of friends will start messaging.
Uh-huh.
Tapos, actually, hindi naman siya ganun kadali. Kasi parang we're trying to establish an identity here. So I do have to look at their profile. Sometimes just to make it easier, I just ask them point blank, what do you want? And then, yeah, like, you want a bike or something? Actually, just to make this faster then, there are organizations already approaching me. So at least hindi siya pa isa-isang tao. Parang if you have a shirt of this org on the fist, then mas madali siyang ikalat. Or universities have also approached me already. And I've yet to do it because that's a very long list. Kevin, help! And then going back to interesting ones, I don't know if you can see this.
Or maybe just describe it. Kasi pa, I don't think we can capture it. But if you can.
Okay, well, this is Ben Cab. Yeah. And then ano pa bang interesting? Well, this is Kuya Boji from Batibot.
Amazing. And it does look Kuya Boji.
Yeah.
Diba? Oh. So si Ben Cab approached you, texted you, messaged you.
Si Annie actually, mm-hmm. Annie Sartu. So uh-oh. Yeah, and then she asked me to make one for Mang Ben. Uh-oh. So of course, parang kasi Mang Ben then has met my father. I think they worked together at some mm-hmm. point. Mm-hmm. So parang family na rin, so you don't say no to that. In fact, mm-hmm. I don't say no. I just take in whatever I can.
You gotta rest because we were texting each other late at night at magdo-drawing ka pa. Ito naman si Kevin. Kevin, what are your plans? You're gonna help out Jason here? It's enough. Or is it enough that you created this moment?
Oh, lang ako, Kevin.
Actually, may plan kami na i-combine lahat ng mga entries into one big image. Mm. And then, ikakalat namin sa possibly offline, hindi na online, sa streets. Mm.
So Kevin, they're telling us to wrap up now because we still have a bunch of items to take care of. But your final thoughts and your final thoughts on this movement, as you said, has come, you know, it has a life of its own now. It's taken over Jason's life.
Okay. Ako, isang simpleng mamamayan na naglalabas ng kanyang saloobin sa pamamagitan ng pagguhit. I am using my talent and my platform to call out the Duterte administration for its cruel, unreasonable, and arbitrary use of power and control. I get a lot of questions lately kung tungkol saan yung artwork ko and if ako ba raw ay against sa government. And I think the better question to ask is, sawang-sawa na ang mga tao sa kapalpakan ng pang-aabuso, pagpapatahimik, pagpapakulong, pinabatay ang mga pangkaraniwang mamamayan at sa gitna pa ng pandemya. Is the government against its own people? Kasi kung oo, ay dapat na itong palitan. Magparehistro tayo and let's vote them out in the coming elections. And that's it.
Thank you so much, Kevin, for joining us today. And Jason, your hope as well. What is your message to those who are not as brave as you, as Jason, as Kevin, and as brave as the others who continue to push and ask the questions that need to be asked? Your thoughts on that, Jason?
If you can't go on the streets, just use your fist, I guess.
Thanks a lot, Visual.
Kevin said most of what I wanted to say, but yeah.
We get you. Thanks a lot. Jason Moss there, visual artist, and also Kevin Raimundo, also known as Kevin Calbo and TK. Guys, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Really appreciate it. You take care. Keep safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Carmina.
Bye. We're going to take a break now. Still ahead, the Philippines' Olympic campaign gets off to a good start in Tokyo. Sports news when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Laban lang.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
More news. Weightlifter Haydelyn Diaz broke the Philippines' 20-year Olympic medal drought in the 2016 Rio Games. She'll get another crack at the Philippines' first ever Olympic gold, along with 18 other Filipino athletes. Migs Bustos introduces us to Team Philippines.
19 Filipino athletes have qualified for the Tokyo Olympics. This year's delegation is led by seasoned athlete Haydelyn Diaz, who broke the country's 20-year medal drought with a silver in the 2016 Rio Olympics. Speaking to ANC, Diaz said she's confident she can perform well, but she also admitted to feeling some pressure to get a gold.
Ayokong sabihin naman nalo ako ng gold. Kung hindi, ipakita ko na lang na nandun na yung medal.
Yeah.
At nandun yung gold medal or anong medal na yan, bronze or silver, ang gusto ko lang sabihin is my ultimate goal is to do my best for the country, for myself, and to God, and for the people behind me.
Also ready to give his all is pole vaulter EJ Obiena, who has been shattering his own Philippine records in various competitions in Europe this year.
Every competition I go, I want to win. And that's a goal. It's not an easy thing to do. I'm not saying I can do it right away, but it's not impossible. I have a shot, and that's all I can ask for. So I'm going for it.
Making his Olympic debut, Chris Nevarez, the first Filipino rower to qualify for the Games in 2 decades.
Isang karangalan din po na may represent ulit yung watawat ng Pilipinas sa Olympics po. After ng paghihirap namin sa buong team, hindi lang ako, hindi lang yung mga coaches, talagang buong team kami naghirap sa training. Nung nag-umpisa sila, talagang yun na yung goal namin na may makapag-Olympics ulit. Kahit sino, mas makikilala na yung rowing sa buong bansa dahil sa nga po na may na-qualify na event, yung pong event ko, single scull men's.
Phil-Am sprinter Christina Nat, who holds the Philippine record for 100 and 200 meters, says staying healthy has been the biggest challenge ahead of the Olympics. That's a fact she knows all too well after testing positive for COVID-19 despite being fully vaccinated.
The day before I got the news from a teammate that I tested positive and we are actually out of competition. So I found out the day of the competition and I was like, well, I can't. Now they pulled me from the competition. I was supposed to have two. They pulled me from both of those competitions. And then the next day I went to bed and then I woke up and my phone is like, all you see is like these crazy notifications. I'm like, what is going on? And then the Philippines declared me in the 200 and yeah, it's official that I officially qualified for the 200. Mm. So it was a weird feeling. Cause I was like, okay, I have COVID, we're in a pandemic, but I'm still going to the Olympics. So it was just like, I was excited, but I was like, this is weird. Like I have COVID, so I don't know how I'm supposed to like feel. So it was just like a lot of mixed emotions.
For Phil M. swimmer Remedy Rule, the pandemic pause has been a roller coaster of emotions.
I swim pretty much year round. I've swam year round since I was 10. And the longest break I've taken is usually just a few weeks, maybe even just a week some years. And so with COVID, I took over 2 months off in the pool. So that was the longest I'd been out of the pool. So that was just definitely an adjustment. It was challenging because, you know, I love swimming and I loved what I was doing. I came off of a high of representing the Philippines at Worlds and at the SEA Games. And then it was like, oh, the whole world like came to a close. And so that was definitely a hard adjustment.
Rounding out the Philippines' Olympic roster are golfers Yuka Saso, Juvic Pagunsan, and Bianca Pagdanganan. Boxers Sumir Marshall, Irish Magno, Nesty Petesho, and Carlo Paalam. Gymnast Carlos Yulo, weightlifter Elrin Ando, skateboarder Marjeline Dedal, shooter Jason Valdez, judoka Kiyomi Watanabe, taekwondo Jin Kurt Barbosa, and swimmer Luke Gebby. With 19 athletes in the Games, the biggest Philippine delegation since the 2000 Olympics in Sydney, the Philippine Sports Commission is confident podium finishes are not out of the question. Migs Bustos, ABS-CBN News.
And earlier today, Filipino rower Chris Nevarez advanced to the quarterfinals of the men's single sculls after finishing third in the preliminary heats. The 21-year-old Nevarez is the first Filipino Olympic rower since Benjamin Tolentino participated in the 2000 Sydney Olympics. That'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us the whole week this week. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcast. Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.
I, Rodrigo.